Stuck between the studied indie of the Smiths and the stadium-bothering rock of U2, Echo and the Bunnymen were one of a kind. Shackled with one of the oddest names in post-punk, yet adored by the UK music press, their psychedelic doom-infused first three albums set them up as one of the most exciting bands in Britain, with singles like Rescue, A Promise and The Cutter slowly gaining them higher chart placings and a more rabid fanbase. But on the cusp of the mainstream, with the potential to be the biggest band of the 80s, they went to France, changed their sound, and put all their faith in a song their singer heard in a dream. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of the Killing Moon. This video is sponsored by Surfshark. Imagine this, you want to watch the Austin Powers films, but they are not on UK Netflix. What you need is a VPN to trick Netflix into thinking you're in the US, where they do have all three films. Surfshark is that VPN. Just connect to the service and refresh the page, and it's there for you to enjoy. US Netflix users can also sneak onto a UK server to watch the vast array of Ghibli films available on UK Netflix. For example, Ponyo, or even My Neighbor Totoro. And it works on all kinds of streaming services and regions. Whether on your laptop, phone, or TV, Surfshark is easy to install and able to be run on an unlimited number of devices at the same time from one subscription. So that's safe, unrestricted surfing wherever you go. You can get Surfshark VPN at the link on screen. And if you enter the promo code TRASHTHEORY, you'll receive 83% off and 3 extra months for free. But with a 30-day money-back guarantee, you have plenty of time to try out Surfshark risk-free. So surf safely with Surfshark. And now back to the video. Echo and the Bunnymen started in Liverpool in 1978. Initially, the group consisted of Ian McCulloch on vocals, Will Sargent on guitar, Les Patterson on bass, and a Korg Mini Pops Jr. drum machine, which legend, but not the band, has assigned the name Echo. Our name was always intended to be funny. The Bunnymen was the funniest name. It was meant to deflate all that meaningful name thing. Spurned on by the punk movement, and especially local group Big in Japan, the Bunnymen sound was indebted to the alternative 60s, the likes of Velvet Underground, Leonard Cohen, Love and The Doors. McCulloch in particular had seen his future in the shock red mullet of Ziggy Stardust, performing Starman on Top of the Pops. There's a starman waiting in the sky. I only ever wanted, since the age of 13, to be the best singer of the best band in the world. McCulloch had previously been in a group called The Crucial Three with Julian Cope and Pete Wiley. They lasted 6 weeks before splitting, yet their members would all become pivotal. Cope would form The Teardrop Explodes and Wiley The Mighty Wah. These groups, alongside OMD and later Frankie Goes to Hollywood and Dead or Alive, would form the Liverpool New Wave scene. The Bunnymen's first show was supporting The Teardrop Explodes at Eric's in Liverpool, but their drum machine malfunctioned and began throwing a fit. Will was on his knees going, "It's not working." I was like, "It's my first time and your drum machine's fucking crap. Come on, get those ohms and watts going." It could have been embarrassing. There were about 70 people there. I just stood there and looked at them. After about 10 minutes, the drum machine started and we were off running. People were spellbound. We were in our flow. No, honestly, we were. Through gigs around Liverpool, they caught the attention of Bill Drummond, former guitarist for Big in Japan, future member of the KLF. But in 1978, he was just looking for some bands to manage. In May 1979, Echo and the Bunnymen released their first single, The Pictures on My Wall, on Drummond's Zoo label. It didn't make the UK pop charts, but it went number 24 on the indie chart and earned them a session on The John Peel Show. They signed to Corova after Seymour Stein's Sire and Rob Dickens of Warner Brothers caught the group playing a battle with the bands. But there was one stipulation, that the group trashed the drum machine and replace it with a flesh and blood one. Pete DeFreitas took its place. Their first pop charting single would follow in May 1980. Won't you come on down to my Rescue making its way to number 62 in the UK charts. But its parent album, Crocodiles, released 2 months later, would go top 20. Already the band were showing their ability to create an incredible sense of drama and aiming for an absolutely huge textured sound, said Crocodiles producer Ian Brody, later of the Lightning Seeds. Separately, what they're playing didn't seem that great. But somehow, when the four of them touched together, it ignited the blue paper. You could say to them, play A to D. They'd all join in and play A to D, and it would just sound great. The four of them created some kind of chemical reaction. Being in the post-punk bubble, there were comparisons with Joy Division, Bauhaus, and Public Image Limited. The doom that pervaded Crocodiles, joined with McCulloch's sonorous voice, cryptic lyrics, and expertly disheveled hair, became a trademark. The group's overcoated attire, suiting their rain-soaked sound. 1981's Heaven Up Here would continue their upward trajectory. Remaining in the UK album chart longer and climbing higher, reaching number 10. The Bunnymen had converted the NME readers, but were the Top of the Pops crowd ready for them? By 1983, under Drummond's cultish supervision, Echo and the Bunnymen were going from strength to strength, but the musical climate was shifting. Their doomy peers had moved on. New Order had just released Blue Monday, and firmly set their allegiance with all things disco. Bauhaus broke up, and Public Image Limited had their biggest pop hit with This Is Not a Love Song. While the Sisters of Mercy were on the horizon, the Bunnymen ended up as the last great northern doomy band. Post-punk groups with their eyes on stadiums, bands like Simple Minds, Big Country and U2, were latching upon their impressive sound, utilising copious reverb guitars, massive drums and booming vocals, and started having their own success. McCulloch resented this, and used every interview opportunity to lay into them. Bono Nobbo, that's his fucking name, what a gibbering leprechaunish twat, he's up to no good. McCulloch's digs at his contemporaries, and affection for overstatement, earned him the nickname Mac the Mouth. He would later reflect on his interview technique. I hate being called arrogant, but when I've said stuff like, I'm a genius, or I'm the son of God, it was only supposed to be funny. I said those things as a way of taking control of boring interviews. Now I think it's made us look like a narrow version of what we're capable of. What they were capable of was realigned with 1983's intense and complicated Porcupine album, featuring longer songs with frequent passages of unrelenting bleakness. Amid intermittent psychedelic freakouts. McCulloch's wails were more desperate than ever to be heard over the cacophony. Even the singles Back of Love and The Cutter, the rare moments of almost levity, feature psycho string stabs, strangled violin hooks, and noise rock swells. It showed the band in a bad place, not helped by Drummond and their label forcing the band to record it twice, as the first version was too uncommercial. Their mood matched the music inside. The first two records were done with a lot more naivety. With Porcupine, we questioned what we were doing for the first time, whether it was right or not. The composition of the music was the first thing, and from there we went on to question our abilities in writing of songs, or, well, why we were even doing it basically. Nothing seemed so intuitive as it used to, and I always thought it had to be intuitive. And yet, it was their most chart-successful album ever, peaking at number 2 in the UK. Out of the bands that formed out of the Crucial Three, the Bunnymen were the last to get a top 10 single. The Teardrop Explodes got to number 6 with Reward in early 1981. In January 1983, the Mighty Wah's Story of the Blues peaked at number 3. And then you realize you've got nothing left to lose. And in February the same year, The Cutter made it to number 8. Conquering myself until I see another hurdle approaching. The Bunnymen appeared on the same episode of Top of the Pops as then admirers U2, who were there due to New Year's Day's top 10 placing. Instead of jumping on this opportunity to increase their venue sizes and monopolize on this success, the Bunnymen played Iceland and the isolated Outer Hebrides of Scotland on advice from their manager, under the pretense that the locations of those shows were positioned on spiritual ley lines that would somehow benefit the band further. Drummond also felt the band should break up, as he had suggested that a truly great group should not outlast their welcome, and 5 years was the perfect lifespan. While the Bunnymen didn't want to call time just yet, they felt a change was needed. We'd become this rock band, having hits, where people said we were going to be bigger than the biggest group of our generation. And I just thought, sod it, let's go on a tangent. Let's do something that these bastards wouldn't think of in a million years. The Killing Moon was the first track assembled for album number 4, what would become Ocean Rain. It and the album in general was a decisive left turn, away from the established and commercially successful sound present on Porcupine. We'd all been given acoustic guitars by Washburn, and we were all playing around with them, so the album was heading to a more acoustic world. I was going over to Mac's house, we had a 4-track there, and we were just coming up with riffs and chord sequences and stuff like that. The Killing Moon was one of them, and it just sort of developed. The spark of The Killing Moon had been a moment of divine intervention, its chorus coming to McCulloch in a dream. I didn't pore over it for days on end. One morning I sat bolt upright in bed, with this line in my head. You don't dream things like that and remember them. That's why I've always half credited the lyric to God. It's never happened before or since. The initial chord sequence for the verses was taken from David Bowie's Space Oddity, played in reverse order.
So instead of ground control to major tone, I went. And thereby, I created the greatest song ever written.
After continued experimentation, the song ended up sounding little like its calling point, but its echoey, eerie atmosphere and space theme remained, if only for its references to blue moons and starlit skies. Under blue moon I saw you, in starlit nights I saw you. Though McCulloch had wanted Bowie to produce the album, they instead ended up with assistance from David Lord, just off working on the iSchool Works self-titled LP. Though most of The Killing Moon was recorded in Crescent Studios in Bath, vocals and extra instrumentation were recorded in Paris, France, calling back to their initial experiments in orchestration from 1982's Back of Love. The Bunnymen employed a 35-piece orchestra to achieve the widescreen sound they had always been searching for. The twangy, disjointed guitar riff that opens The Killing Moon was absent from demo versions of the track. This was a studio invention. It was just something I did when we were tuning up. Then we went out for a curry, and when we came back, producer David Lord had looped it up and punched it back in. We all thought it sounded great. I spent the next 20-odd years trying to remember how I did it. McCulloch soon found working with Lord to be untenable and abandoned the Killing Moon. David Lord was a load of crap and a tosser, the most unaptly named bastard you could meet. It was all going wrong, so I went to the boozer with cellist Adam Peters. Then I got a bad cold. The others suggested I re-sing it when we got back to Liverpool, but I said, I'm not doing it. It's ruined. When they did get back home, De Freitas was the one to convince McCulloch that the track was worth another shot. After re-drumming with brushes instead of sticks, realigning it with McCulloch and or God's vision, he would re-record his vocals at Amazon Studios in Kirkby, under the watchful eye of future Pixies producer, Gil Norton. Instrumentally, The Killing Moon was inspired by a trip to Russia that Sargent and Patterson went on just before the album sessions. We went to Leningrad, then this place called Kazan, where nobody from outside Russia had been since 1943 or something. We went to a museum full of tractor parts, and this very strange party organized by the young communists. But there was a lot of music, and we came back full of ideas of Russian balalaika bands, which Les used for the middle of the song, this rumbling mandolin-style bass thing. All in all, the song is this achingly dramatic, 6-minute ballad, by its end straining under the weight of Sargent's deathless solo. And McCulloch's haunted la-la-las. What the song is about is up for interpretation. Though he has implied links with divinity, predestiny, and other high-minded concepts, for the most part, McCulloch isn't telling. I never think about too many specifics. When I write lyrics like The Killing Moon, it sounds vaguer than it actually is. I always think, this is the meaning. I never really tell people what the meaning is to all the songs, because that surely spoils their journey. Released in January 1984, despite McCulloch's claims of it being the greatest song ever, The Killing Moon only managed number 9 in the UK charts. Fate, up against your will. One place lower than The Cutter. Ocean Rain disappointed too, entering at number 4 before slipping further down the chart. But it was their first album to enter the top 100 of the Billboard album chart, peaking at number 87, kicking off their American flirtation with the band that would continue with 1987's Lips Like Sugar. And their cover of The Doors' People Are Strange on the Lost Boys soundtrack. People are strange. Critically, reviews were mixed. While the UK rock press had adored their previous three albums, Ocean Rain was met with confused shrugs. Pre-release, the Bunnymen's management had sent out a statement from McCulloch, in his tongue-in-cheek arrogance, claiming that the record was the greatest album ever made. 5 years in, and critics were sick of his constant hyperbole. Enemy's Bieber Koff wrote, "Ocean Rain accelerates the unseemly slide of a once witty and occasionally inventive pop rock group into the swamp of pomp." Rolling Stone summed it up in their 2-star review as too often a monochromatic dirge of banal existential imagery cloaked around the mere skeleton of a musical idea. There were positive reviews as well, but for the most part, the romance with the press was over. Drummond would leave as manager before the end of 1984 to start his own aspirations of pop stardom, in various guises, all leading to the KLF. Despite having released 4 albums in 5 years, aside from a best of compilation, the Bunnymen wouldn't release another one until 1987. Their self-titled album, nicknamed the Grey Album by McCulloch due to its bleak cover and end of days mood of production, would further their success in the US, but drive the band further apart, amid drugs and alcohol. By this point in 1987, their former acolytes and rivals, U2, had just released The Joshua Tree and were unrivaled as the biggest band in the world, a position that the Bunnymen could have held if they just wanted it more. McCulloch ended up leaving the band in 1988. The Bunnymen carried on without him, replaced by ex-St. Vitus dance frontman Noel Burke, to decreasing interest from anyone but their faithful. Though McCulloch would return in 1997, the 80s were long gone. Time has been kind to the Killing Moon and Ocean Rain, having not been weighed down by the dated synths of the 80s contemporaries. Now, it's timeless. The album is now considered to be the Bunnymen's essential record, while The Killing Moon has become one of the definitive songs in the post-punk canon. It went on to gain a new generation of fans when it was used in 80s nostalgia movies, Gross Point Blank and Donnie Darko. At least on one occasion, McCulloch has implied that Richard Kelly's twisting time travel teen drama was inspired by the song itself. As the plot revolves around an ominous bunny man, it's not that big a stretch. I'd mentioned somewhere that The Killing Moon was about predestiny, and he wrote the whole fucking film about it, cheeky bastard. He gave us this pittance one-off fee for the use of the song, saying it was just a little indie film, but forgot to mention that Drew Barrymore was behind it, who had more money than Howard Hughes. Great as it is, he should at least have given us a credit for the idea. Just like Richard Kelly, loads of bands have taken bits of Echo and the Bunnymen for their own, whether that be with diverse covers from the likes of Bernie Airlines, Aha, Ghost, Nouvelle Vague, Idlewild, Lagwagon, and Pavement, or the various indie-leaning bands that have incorporated string orchestration into their grand-scale anthems. Arcade Fire, Coldplay, The Killers, Flaming Lips, Verve, Blur, and even Radiohead. And this is to say nothing of their enduring influence on the dream pop, shoegaze, and post-hardcore genres. Echo and the Bunnymen never made it to the stadiums of their contemporaries. In a way, it's sad that the group never made that final leap toward household name status. But then with a name like theirs, that was never the goal. I was looking at some old photos from the Peel sessions and stuff, and I was like, how the fuck didn't we not only be the biggest band in the world, but the richest? How come we're not married to Miss World? But we did alright. It was just, we didn't want it particularly. It was more fun taking the piss, I thought. Taking the piss or not, the gothic majesty of The Killing Moon will live on. Because as long as there are blue moons and starlit skies, winter nighttime walks will always have a soundtrack. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed it, why not give it a like, a comment, maybe even subscribe and hit that bell. I'd like to take this opportunity to shout out the absolutely unhinged individual that bought me an LP copy of the Spice Girls debut via my Amazon wishlist. Oscar Seville, thank you very much. Thanks also to my new top tier supporters on Patreon, Manuel Feeman and Marco North, as well as everyone else that supports me. You are awesome. See you in 2 weeks for another video that patrons voted for.